Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. Life on Earth persisted this week despite strong headwinds, and so we gather once again to assess mankind's technological progress, in the vain hope that understanding and knowledge in this area might serve as a calming salve for our overstimulated brains. Or at least that's how I see it. But with context established, I now subtly tease that alongside the Battlefield 6 launch, Intel actually talked about Arc Celestial this week. Sort of. AMD debuted their grand scheme for AI dominance alongside OpenAI, so suck it, Nvidia. And Microsoft boldly proceeded with their plan to convince as many people as possible to stop using Windows. Not that much encouragement has been needed for those who recall a simpler time when your PC's operating system didn't track your every move and serve as a glorified ad targeting app. But at least NFTs are back too. Remember, that means nice fall temperatures now. So on with the tech news. Today's video is brought to you by Thermaltake's View 380 XL Tempered Glass ARGB Mid-Tower Chassis. With an innovative dual-chamber design and angled front intake to direct airflow towards components, keeping even power-hungry high-end PC builds cool while maintaining an unobstructed view. Hey, that's why it's called the View 380. Keep things clean with hidden connector motherboard support, keep cool with four included ARGB fans and multiple radiator mount locations for up to 360mm AIOs, and have fun building with plenty of room for cable management and added storage. For more on the View 380 XLTG ARGB from Thermaltake, click the sponsor link in the video description. We begin this week in Arizona, where as of last week, a bunch of tech media outlets and influencers, who are apparently all way cooler than me, were invited by Intel to experience the Arizona heat and lack of humidity whilst enjoying food and local music performances, eventually culminating in getting suited up for a grand tour of Fab 52, where Panther Lake and Clearwater Forest wafers are currently being produced on Intel's 18A process. A lot of content came out alongside Intel announcements that Panther Lake based laptops will launch in Q1 2026, so check the links in the description if you want more. But for me, there were three big takeaways from this event. First, despite a wildly tumultuous year thus far, Intel is pushing ahead with their 18A based products and is debuting them in a very public way, signaling either a secure confidence in the performance of their next gen parts, or a desperate need to rebuild momentum and ride the wave of positive news for Intel as a company that we've discussed in more recent weeks, mostly due to massive cash infusions that have, for the moment, put off larger fears of Intel collapsing entirely. Second, as most of the focus was on the aforementioned Panther Lake parts, which are made for laptops and mobile devices, and Clearwater Forest, which is for Xeon server and data center chips, there was less to discuss in my particular niche of consumer desktop CPUs and GPUs, so perhaps it was good that my invitation to the event got lost in the mail. But third, actually there was some ARC discussion, which included references to third-gen Celestial architecture, so I will focus on that. XeSS 3 will be supported by all games that currently include XeSS 2 support, which is cool, meaning multi-frame gen can be enabled via the driver along with ray reconstruction and upscaling features. This was highlighted because Panther Lake 8-core and 16-core mobile CPUs launching in early 2026 will include 4 or 12 Xe3 cores for the iGPU. Xe3 cores, so that's third-gen ARC Xe cores, which means this is the debut of ARC Celestial, right? Well, yes, but in true Intel fashion, it's unnecessarily complicated. As this chart awkwardly shows, Panther Lake does use Xe3 cores, but it's also grouped in as Intel Arc B series, while Next Arc family lists Xe3P cores, with the P meaning plus, which Intel hopes doesn't remind you of 14 nanometer plus 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 plus. After some confusion, good old Tap, aka Tom Peterson, clarified with Adam from PC World that Xe3 is Arc Celestial. They're just not calling it that. Perhaps they fear the name Celestial, and as we all know, fear of a name only increases fear of the thing itself. But to sum up, Panther Lake uses Arc Celestial Xe3 cores, who just weren't granted the rank of master, which is insulting, but so be it. At least hope remains that Arc Celestial discrete GPUs may still see the light of day at some point in 2026, with Xe3 Plus cores even, and for anyone who wants a more complete rundown of Intel's announcements, I recommend Leo's hype-free synopsis over on KitGuru, it's linked in the description. Speaking of things that deserve less hype, the AI bubble continues to bulge, and it has been inflated with even more hot air as of Monday, when AMD and OpenAI announced a strategic partnership to deploy 6 gigawatts of AMD GPUs. But wait, you might say, isn't that very similar to NVIDIA's plan with OpenAI to deploy 10 gigawatts of GPUs from just a couple weeks ago? Absolutely, but allow me to explain the subtle differences. NVIDIA's letter of intent starts with $10 billion in cash going from NVIDIA to OpenAI for the first 1 gigawatt data center buildout, which will cost OpenAI $50 billion, give or take, and no one seems totally sure where the other $40 billion will come from. Still, that deal can scale up to as much as $100 billion in cash from NVIDIA as OpenAI builds up to 10 gigawatts of AI slop producing data centers if things continue as planned, while OpenAI uses some amount of that money to lease GPUs from NVIDIA to install in said data centers. Meanwhile, with the AMD deal, OpenAI will pay cash to AMD for an initial 1 gigawatts worth of AMD Instinct MI450 GPUs that they want to go online by the second half of 2026. And as sort of a gift with purchase, OpenAI also gets a bunch of AMD stock, up to 160 million shares if they go ahead with the full 6 gigawatt buildout, which would give OpenAI a 10% stake in AMD, something that has already become more valuable as AMD stock prices went up 25% upon the publication of this news. Definitely not circular in nature at all, and certainly one shouldn't also consider that NVIDIA would also have a 2% initial stake in OpenAI that can scale up to 20%. So NVIDIA would own some of OpenAI, and OpenAI would own some of AMD, furthering the incestuous Ouroboros-like relationship between would-be tech rivals, or as many have called it, a big ol' AI bubble circle jerk, which explains the OpenAI logo. When pinged for comments on the AMD deal, Jensen said, "It's imaginative. It's unique. I'm surprised that they would give away 10% of the company before they even built it, and so anyhow, it's clever, I guess." Boldly tongue-in-cheek statements there, Jensen, but I suppose whether AMD succeeds or fails in the AI race now, NVIDIA still wins. Speaking of wins, Windows 11 hasn't had many of those, and Microsoft's plan seems to be to continue that trend. They're doing hateful Windows things yet again, coincidentally timed with the end of Windows 10 support, by making it even harder to install Windows 11 with a local account. So if you have a Windows 11 installation USB drive with a build from earlier this year, I'd recommend holding on to it for now. Why? Because under the guise of ensuring your device is set up correctly, Microsoft is doing everything they can to force you to use a Microsoft account when you set up your computer, with the real reason being so they can hoover up your usage data and track even more info about you and the PC that you own. This week's preview build 26220.6772 on Microsoft's dev channel, which will likely be included in future production builds, disables the start ms-cxh local only option that now joins the legacy OOBE/bypass NRO command in no longer offering a clear pathway for local account setup. Of course, new workarounds are popping up, with the easiest being to just use a Windows 11 USB installer from earlier in 2025 that still works with the old workarounds, and then just run Windows Update. But there's also command prompt registry edits like the one shared by the Bob Pony that seem to work too, for now, but workarounds can introduce their own pitfalls and security issues, particularly for less tech-savvy users. Microsoft clearly hopes that further obfuscation will result in said users giving in and just going with a Microsoft account, but I'd say this is more likely to get a lot of people to finally try out Linux. Thanks, Microsoft. And now come the tech briefs, which occasionally run long, but have been formatted to fit your screen. Battlefield 6 launched at long last on Friday, nearly 4 years after the previous installment, and while there have been some snags, such as the EA app throwing an error, overall reception seems quite positive, which just feels weird given how critical gamers can be. And perhaps some thanks is due to Borderlands 4, which launched last month but struggled in terms of performance. Battlefield 6, as tested by the fine gents over at Hardware Unboxed, can easily hit playable frame rates at 1080p even without the aid of upscaling, and that's using the overkill graphics setting, where cards like the 9060 XT and 5060 Ti 16GB hit around 60 FPS. That solid foundation means upscaling, which also works quite well, can boost frame rates higher without much of a trade-off in visual quality, so even older GPUs have plenty of levers to play with to maximize performance in what is being described as, amazingly, a well-optimized game. in 2025. Speaking of optimal results, I have stated my appreciation many times for AMD's approach to socket longevity, starting with AM4 and now continuing with AM5. Rumors in recent weeks seem to be substantiated that desktop CPUs based on AMD's next-gen architecture, Zen 6, will remain compatible with existing AM5 motherboards, as ASUS came right out and said so in marketing materials for their new B850M As You Wish motherboard. It just says it right here. Kind of sticks out at you like a six-fingered man, which seems fitting considering the rocky terrain, but apart from the Zen 6 reveal, I'm hoping ASUS continues this motherboard theme and follows up with an X870, hello, my name is Inigo Montoya, you killed my father, prepare to die, extreme model. Probably an ROG board. As you wish, A-Y-W, supposed to be as you wish. Princess Bride reference, of course, Joe. Okay, finally, if you have a 140mm computer case fan and a wasp infestation, this post is for you. Oh, and you'll need a 3D printer, too. Cronus88 on the 3D printing subreddit recently shared a unique solution for eliminating a pervasive gang of wasps that moved into an exterior wall of their home over the spring and summer. Exterminators recommended insecticide foggers or tearing the wall down, but instead, Cronus used a Bamboo Lab H2D 3D printer to create a form-fitted housing which was installed into the wall's point of ingress, and when equipped with a 140mm fractal case fan, then served as a one-way exit for the nasty flying buggers. Wasps got blown out but couldn't get back in, eventually starving to death outside the nest, which is no less than they deserve. It's an innovative tech-based solution that requires no chemical insecticides, and the design has been uploaded to printables for anyone who's facing a similar battle against flying, stinging, asshole wasps. But there you have it, guys. Tech news for the week, and if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested, and you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call, too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.